The 1,000 contestants began in fine style, paddling their way through the slower traffic, not really expecting what lay ahead. Much like most of Australia at the present moment, the South African countryside is bone dry, and all competitors can look forward to more of a cross-country run than a 120-kilometre paddle. It is estimated that they will have to carry their craft for more than 80% of the race, running along dried-up riverbeds where there is usually fast-flowing rivers. The three-day race is divided into three stages, and after the first day's paddling, Graham Pope Ellis, with maybe a touch of heavenly guidance, and his crewman Tim Cornish crossed the line to lead the double section, with Mike Tocknell the leader in the singles.
Well, Mike, I started playing golf when I was about 10 years old, and I've been playing for the last a dozen years or so. I was played junior golf in Scotland and around Britain, and then when I was 17 I was in the States for 2 years on a golf scholarship there. Came back from there when I was 20, and that year, 1981, I made the Walker Cup team for Great Britain and Ireland and won the Scottish Amateur, so that was when my career really started to take off on the senior level. And also that year I won the East of India Amateur. This year, well sorry, 1982, I was captain of the Great Britain youth team, which is under 22, and the Scottish youth team, and I played for Scotland and played for Europe against South America.
That'd be a distinction in itself, being captain not only of the Scottish team but also of the British team.
Yeah, that was really nice. That was something I enjoyed, because I'd been captain of the British junior and Scottish junior teams, and then to go on and be captain of the under 22 team, you know, that was quite nice.
Tournament organiser Frank Scott announced another coup for the tournament with the entry of an Italian team.
Yes, Mike, we've been lucky enough to get the Italian national youth side out to play in our tournament. And it's been brought about by one of our local pros, and Tom Linsky, who is now their national coach over there. And he's put them into play out here, and their track form, what they've sent out to us, is very, very good.
One player, Emmanuel Bolognese, apparently has a super reputation.
He's rated the second top junior in the world. He ran second in the world in the Doug Sanders World Championship in England last year, and they feel that he will go on to be one of the top amateurs in the world.
Situation, but a lot of countries sending their junior teams.
Kron Bickler, 19, overtook Poland's Małgorzata Tlaka to lead after the first leg to win with a combined time of 1 minute 38.35 seconds. The race was held under heavy snowfall, fog and wind, and there was a heavy toll on the favourites. World Cup overall leader Erika Hess of Switzerland and second-placed Tamara McKinney of the United States both went out on the first leg when they failed to negotiate a treacherous icy passage. In second place was Italian Maria Rossi Quaro, who produced the fastest second run of 50.88 to move from fifth place to overall second in the combined run.
Thanks. About 1,700 students in the Hunter region sat for the higher school certificate at the end of last year. The Board of Senior School Studies is waiting until after the revision of marks before announcing the state's top students. However, a number of students in the Hunter region have gained aggregates over 450. Those students who stand out include Ken Koo from Maris Brothers High School, Craig Hume and Wayne Wolfgang from Musselbrook High, Shirley Bowen from Gloucester and Richard Cooper from Lambton High School. Once again, the Department of Education has expressed some concern about the interpretation of results by employers.
The Board of Senior Studies this year has published to each student who's receiving results a small document which explains the marking system and how the marks should be interpreted. And those students are advised to take that document along to any future employers so that the employers will understand what the marks mean. For example, an aggregate of 250 marks, which in some people's minds may be seen as just a pass, is in fact the average mark obtained by students and will get many students into a university, for example. So it's quite a good aggregate to get.
The boys have been friends since they began school 2 years ago. Their parents had repeatedly told them to stay away from the railway lines, but yesterday Andrew disobeyed. Scott was standing by this fence when the accident happened.
Well, when Andrew jumped onto the ladder, he was looking at me and he fell down and his leg fell onto the train track and he got run over.
And what did you do then?
Well, I ran over and dragged him along to the fence and I got someone to get help.
I see. So you couldn't drag him any further than the fence?
No.
That's for the night.
And I was crossing
through the parking area.
After making sure his friend was safe, Scott ran to tell Andrew's parents what had happened. Andrew was taken to the fire station and an ambulance was called to transport him to the Martyr Hospital.
Despite a 3-hour operation, surgeons at the Martyr were unable to save Andrew's right forefoot, which was badly mutilated by the train. He will also have to undergo a number of skin grafts, as much of the skin on his leg was torn off during the accident.
Mike, we've had a lot of trouble with the Waratah Oval. The ground itself is in a very poor state as far as grassing. We had a meeting at the beginning of the year with the Oval Board and everything, and they were going to see if they could do something about it. But at this stage, nothing's been done, and so the Waratah Football Club is taking a new look at things on a professional way, and we're that struck a deal for the sports centre, which has been very good financially for us, as well as we reckon we can drag more people into the ground with access of cars and everything like this. And
Colin, what constitutes the actual deal with the International Sports Centre?
It's a 3-year deal. We won't go into the financial things, I think that's club business, but it is a lot better than what we have been over the last few years.
All your home games will be played at the International Sports Centre. You mentioned before that the Waratah Oval Board and your committee of the football club have got on extremely well and you were trying to work things out. Will your junior games still be played at Waratah or will they be played here also?
No, the juniors will still stay at Waratah Oval. We've got to apply to the Oval Board for permission for the juniors, but we can't see any reason why it can't be given because we've done everything right as far as the Oval Board's concerned.
But can you see any improvement in the Waratah side from the 1982 season to the 83 season?
A very, very big improvement I can see. We've gone ahead and signed Lindsay Garley on a 2-year contract, which has given Lindsay...
..."
relocation of maintenance sail yards has been a controversial issue in the city for some years. Council's first environmental impact statement on the 11-hectare site at Rutherford was conducted in 1980, and the second was completed in November last year. There have been a number of discrepancies between the two statements due to a change in the state pollution control regulations. Residents say these changes have created a complete turnaround in the statement's conclusions. They claim the sail yard's odour and noise will be excessive for residential areas. Council officers who attended the heated meeting last night say the objections will be passed on and discussed at the next council meeting like on February the 8th.
What are you doing?
Companies are in Tokyo right now attempting to negotiate new contracts, and they're having a hard time. One unconfirmed report from Tokyo says the going price for coal is down from around $50 a tonne to $40. Now Japanese buyers are aware of the rail strike and they're querying future reliability. Coal shippers say that a major delay at this stage would only play right into the hands of competing American and South African coal miners.
Waiting to unload at the Port Waratah shiploader. Bumper-to-bumper convoy of trucks made the mission to lay the hour more at the Port Waratah facility as it geared up to handle increased road haulage. Normally most of the loaders coal arrives by rail. The truckies say the lift is the biggest they can remember in the area for a long time, most blamed for at least three trucks during the day. But even though the lift is running the lift, the rail strike ends, ships will just have to wait.
Yannick Noah went into the Masters tournament as the lowest seed, and in the first set, Vitas Gerulaitis had the Frenchman reeling. Noah's attempts to play net were thwarted by Gerulaitis' passing shots. Gerulaitis, a finalist in the Masters last year, took the lead thanks to his own net play. First set, 6-4 Gerulaitis. In the second set, Noah finally solved Gerulaitis' serve. Noah, who claims he plays better with his new dreadlock hairdo, broke and the match swung in his favor. He won the set 6-3. It was all Noah after that. Using his 6-4 height and reach, Noah stormed through Gerulaitis in the final set, 6-2 in an upset victory. The next stop for Noah is against Ivan Lendl.
The two English imports found the going a little tough this morning, having left England amidst snow and sub-zero temperatures. Ken Kaiser, the coach of the Raiders, had them in the Aussie weather conditions quickly. Burke, 25, is a second division player with Barnsley. He had also played for Halifax and Rochdale with great success, and at 6'1", he will fit into the back line well. Gary Watson from County Durham, and 21 years of age, is also a centre-back or left fullback, and has played with Oxford in the third division and Carlisle in the second division. Watson made his representative debut for the England youth team in 1978. Yes. Coach Kaiser is quietly confident that both boys will be a major part of KB's effort in the bid for the National Soccer League title.
Yeah.